Right, so in the 45 minutes, I guess, that I have, I basically want to try three things. And that's very hard to do in 45 minutes, but nonetheless. So I want to talk a little bit or give you an overview over the situation today. Today meaning basically summer 2015 and everything that came afterwards. Then I want to go back into a little bit of historical context of, you know, Austrian, basically or mainly Austrian post-war history, but not only. And then if we have some time at the end, I could go into a little bit more details on what kind of challenges I see coming from that, especially for historians like me, like us. If you are familiar with the German, you know, post-war history of migration, there might not be that many extremely surprising things in that. But nonetheless, keep in mind, Austria is not Germany. It's a different history. And you will see that here at, you know, several points, I think. And I guess it will also be clear why Austria is actually an interesting case study today. It's not just a random, I mean, I can of course randomly talk about Austria because I teach in Austria and that's my field, but it's, I think, actually a very interesting case when it comes to this topic of migration and the so-called refugee crisis in Europe in these days. You know, I said the so-called refugee crisis, and I put that here in quotation marks on my title. I've noticed that this has somehow been left out on the posters you made, which is very unfortunate because that's actually my starting point. So why did I put that in quotation marks, right? I mean, it's not to say that there are no challenges regarding migration and the refugees coming from Africa, Asia, and so on to Europe. But at the same time, I think that this notion or this term migration crisis, as we use it in Europe, is very much a sign of the fact that this whole discussion in Europe is extremely Eurocentric, right? So nobody in Europe cared about refugees when there were 3 million of them in Turkey or in other countries around Syria. Nobody cared really about it in Europe when around 4,000 people died every year in the Mediterranean Sea. We only began to care about it, you know, see, this we is delicate, of course, but no, so what I mean. So we, you know, the people in Europe basically began only to talk about the refugee crisis when it looked like that. At the Austrian border, right? So that's summer 2015, that's the border between Austria and Slovenia. Spielfeld is the name of the little village there. So that was the, I mean, it's, and you can have tons of photos like that, right? So it's, that's what it looked like in the summer of 2015. So when they really arrived at the borders of Europe, whatever that is, then this notion of a migration crisis got started, right? And I think that tells you a lot about the weird Eurocentric perspective when it comes to this topic. And I mean, nothing to say about 65 million people around the world that are on the move and migrating and so on. It's only was basically about that. And I think there is another problem with that term. Migration crisis and how it has been discussed or is still discussed in European countries, like in Austria, but I think Austria is just one case in point. You can also see that it's basically discussed with any history in the background. So, I mean, the discussion in Austria was almost like, oh, now the refugees come and now our country will change. In terms of, you know, new people coming in and so on. And you almost had the same a little bit in Germany. Which of course blots out the whole history of migration to Europe, to countries like Austria and Germany after the Second World War, right? So that's totally absent. So it's, so that it was like very much the impression, oh, now our countries change or have to change or adapt to the situation. In fact, all these countries like Austria and like Germany have been immigration countries for almost five decades, right? But they just did not realize it. And that's, of course, part of the problem today, I think. So it is, so I think also the term refugee crisis or migration crisis tells you a little bit about this very ahistoric approach to what's going on. Nobody talks about history in that context, or if history might be able to tell us something about that, right? It's actually the same for when it comes to the most important concept when we talk about migration in countries like Austria over the last maybe one or two decades. It's the term integration, right? So that is what we expect them to do when they come, that they integrate, whatever that means. And that's also, again, I think, a very ahistoric approach to the whole thing, right? It's like there is a stable culture that has never been changed, and now new people come and they have to integrate into that culture, as if not, you know, the culture has always been changed by migrants and by migration, right? So that's, I think, also this term integration, how we use it. I mean, I know that people use it differently, but the basically dominating use of it or understanding in a broader public and also by politicians is there is a, something like a stable also in this case Austrian culture that has never been changed by migrants and migration. Now new people come and then they somehow have to fit in. So I think these both terms give you a pretty good idea of this, what I think is a very ahistoric approach to the whole situation. Today, what brings me at the very end to the challenges that pose, that are posed by this situation, and not only by this situation, but actually by these 50 years of immigration to countries like Austria, to us as historians. So just to make that even clear with another case, I mean, you know, that's maybe you know what it is, I don't know. I mean, for the Austrian discussion, that has been very important. So, I mean, first we had these images of people waiting at the border. Then you had this image in Austria, and I think it made it very much across the border of Austria. You know, in this truck, I think 71 refugees suffocated to death in summer, August 2015. That's very close to the border, Austria-Hungary, on the Austrian side. So again, you can accept people dying in the Mediterranean Sea, but you cannot accept dying them or accept images of people basically dying on, I say it again, our streets in the middle of Europe. I mean, we don't have, I mean, we have some but not many images of, you know, people on these boats in the Mediterranean Sea and so on, but I mean that was of course much more visible. And it really happened in the, so to say, in the heart of Europe. And while this is going on, or I mean, in the time since then, Austrian politicians came up with very weird ideas, and it's so hard to keep track. I mean, I just had to check, you know, this morning the news. I mean, of course, there's something new going on, and it's the problem with these topics, there's always something new, so it's very hard to keep track. I mean, the first of the weird ideas of our foreign minister from the Conservative Party, that was already last year, was to basically copy the so-called Australian model, setting up, I would call it concentration camps on Greek islands and keep the refugees there before they actually can enter into Europe. So, which also tells you that Greek island is not really Europe. So just a few weeks ago, he came up with the idea, oh, maybe we could also set these camps up, not in Greek islands, but in the Caucasus, or in Georgia or somewhere. So that's very interesting. Gives you some ideas of, you know, what's going on in these minds, right? I mean, that you're, the European Union can set up camps anywhere in the world and illegalize people that are on the move even before they enter the European Union or come close to its border. I mean, that's very interesting. Whatever you want to call it colonial or whatever imperialistic concept, right? Then just, that's actually just 3 weeks ago, the same foreign minister coming back actually from D.C., where he, I think, attended a conference by the State Department on Syria, he went straight to a Frontex boat. You know, Frontex is the European agency dealing with refugees in the Mediterranean Sea, right, and basically preventing them from entering Europe, but also rescuing them. So he visited one of those Frontex boats and came up with an interesting dictum there that the NGOs are actually the problem. I mean, they create the problem by inviting migrants to Europe, and they are to blame for the dead people in the Mediterranean Sea, not the European politicians, but the NGOs. So that was a pretty tough statement, especially in light of the fact that that the NGOs were the only that were able to handle the situation in summer 2015, also in a city like Vienna, when masses of refugees, you know, arrived in Vienna at the main train station there. I mean, the NGOs were the only ones in place, right, that somehow managed that situation, and it was not the politicians who did that. So that blaming of the NGOs for the dead people in the Mediterranean Sea, I mean, that's a very puzzling idea, I think, right? And and then, of course, we just had in the last, or this week, or last week, and that, you know, had a response today in the news. We had even the Social Democrat Chancellor wanted to cancel the relocation program inside the European Union, right? Relocating refugees from Italy and Greece to other European countries. And you know, that brings up all these questions of European solidarity and so on. So our chancellor basically said, you know, we don't need to take in more migrants as part of this relocation program, because we already did take in so many in 2015, which again, of course, puts into question this whole idea of European solidarity, right? If you can cancel it now again, it made no sense. It was about 2,000 refugees, that's all, right, that Austria was supposed to take in now. But that got answered today by Jean-Claude Juncker, saying, you know, you have to. I mean, we'll see what happens. But, I mean, you see where the whole discourse in a country like Austria, like in many other European countries, in some are more blatantly, of course, like in Eastern European countries, but also in a country like Austria, is going very much in a direction against asylum rights and so on. Okay, so that's the situation. Let's go a little, or I mean, let's say a little bit with the situation. You know, in terms of Austria as a migration country or a country of immigration, right? So I don't know if you can, I mean, it's very hard to see. So that is, you know, I hate statistics because they are so unreliable. And they are, you know that. I mean, they are so dangerous, right? I mean, people think, oh, you put a few numbers out there and that's so objective and it tells you the truth or whatever. Especially when, and I think it's especially true for this topic, I mean, if, you know, counting migrants or counting non-nationals, I mean, that's so complicated. Every country does it differently, right? You know, we have this concept of migration background, Migrationshintergrund, that we use in German and Austrian statistics, and we can, of course, in the discussion, we go into that, you know, very problematic concept, but nonetheless, so it's used statistically, but it means something else in Austria and in Germany. They count different people, right? It's there are different rules where when you fall into that category. And even inside Austria, if you have a statistic only of the city of Vienna, they count it differently than the whole Republic of Austria counts it. So, which makes all these statistics very unreliable, and it's especially when it comes to comparisons across Europe. I think it's very hard to get a good idea actually what's going on. Besides the fact that, of course, many people even do not show up here in these statistics, right? Because they are, as you would say here, undocumented. Then they are not in the statistic, right? But they nonetheless live in our cities. So this here gives you non-nationals among the resident population in European Union countries in 2015. So here the first one, what's your guess? You cannot read that. So that's Luxembourg. I mean, that doesn't count as a serious country, of course, right? I mean, this is only EU politicians residing there. And this is why it's also the biggest part, this yellow part, is actually people from other EU countries in Luxembourg. And only the blue part is people from non-EU countries, right? So that's Luxembourg. Then you have Cyprus. Okay, that's a very specific case again. Then you have Latvia and Estonia, also very specific cases, of course, with the Russians living there. And so the next one is Austria. So, that's basically the first, you know, country and, you know, real country. So on that list here. And it's pretty, it's pretty evenly split between EU nationals and people from outside the EU living in Austria, right? And then it's, so here's Germany. It's close, but it's still something in between. Where do we have actually the Netherlands?
What's the scale on the vertical axis?
You mean here?
On the numbers, I can't read the numbers.
That's the percentage.
Yeah, 10%, 20%.
Right, so you have like here in Austria, it's around 15% of non-nationals. So that does, of course, not include... people who have already the citizenship, right? So you would have to count them differently. So if you put together the non-nationals with the people with what we call the migration background, you end up with a number of around 20% in Austria today.
Excuse me, I'm still confused. If you add up all the bars, it goes over 100%. So what is the percentage?
No, it's among the people living in that country. So there's no 100%. 100% is the population of Austria.
So in Luxembourg, 40% of the people living there
in
are
right.
people from European countries. Almost 50% of the people
right.
living in Luxembourg are non-Luxembourg.
100% is the residing population in that country.
Okay.
Right. So that it's 2012, but it's almost the same numbers, a little bit lower. It just gives you the geographic, you know, vision of that when it comes to Europe, right? And it's, of course, not evenly distributed, right? So you have the, no surprise, you have the Eastern European countries with very low rates. I mean, Poland, it's 0.1, right, of non-nationals living in the country. And now we have the whole discourse starting there in Poland and Hungary, right? I mean, we need to stay like homogeneous countries, and right? So that's very much here on the Eastern European, in Eastern Europe. And so you have here the higher numbers in the center and then here on the side. So, right. Switzerland is also a specific case, of course, and not part of the European Union, but it gives you an idea of how it is distributed in Europe, and that there's really a divide here between the Eastern European countries and Central Europe. So that's the numbers of where they come from in Austria. So that's the non-nationals in Austria. Biggest group, Germans. So that's people like me. I'm not Austrian. I moved to Austria 20 years ago from Berlin, just for 1 year, stayed, okay. So that's the biggest group now. Nobody does research on that, right? I mean, we Germans, I mean, so the German-Austrian relationship is extremely delicate for many historical reasons, of course. And everybody in Austria would know, you know, the first second that I'm not Austrian, just when I start speaking, right? Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, we are not part of the problem, right? So somehow we fit in and, you know, we are not undetected, but we are not part of the problem. So the problem starts here. That's people from Serbia, Turkey, Bosnia-Herzegovina, Romania, Croatia, and so on. So, which also tells you that actually the biggest group, if you would combine them, are people from ex-Yugoslavia, right? If you would combine Croatians, Serbs, and Bosnians, that would be the biggest group outnumbering also the Germans, right? And then you have here as the third biggest group, you have people from Turkey. And that, of course, tells you something about the history of migration in post-war Austria. So that's just something, you know, on the side, but it's interesting. That's like Time magazine or it's an Austrian weekly magazine from last year, October last year. We are foreigners, but don't want to confront it. How Austria became the number one immigration country in Europe without actually wanting it. So that was the article about. And it tells you how late Austrians realized that, right? I mean, it's even later than the Germans. And you know that complicated German, you know, history with that still in the 90s, it was, you know, in every speech by politicians, it was actually said, Germany is not a country of immigration, right? It was like a mantra, and it, of course, it told you it's the total opposite. This is why they had to say it again. But they said it nonetheless, and only in 2000, with the new green, red-green government, it somehow changed, right? So Austria is even later in that game. In not confronting it. And only now people in Austria realize, oh wait, I mean, you know, we are actually an immigration country, let's face it, right? But it's still not uncontested, and still politicians wouldn't say it that clearly. We have a state secretariat for integration, there you have it again, since 2011. But I mean, as far as I know, there has still been no clear statement in Austria saying we are a country of immigration and we have to face it and we have to handle it, right? I mean, that's of course part of it. If you don't face it, if you don't confront it, you cannot handle it. So that's just interesting here, how late that comes in. Basically, in the Austrian discussion, this guy here is, by the way, is not a refugee child, but that's our underage foreign minister, right? I mean, that's the youngest foreign minister in the world ever, as you might know. Sebastian Kurz from the Conservative Party might very well be our next chancellor if it's not a right-wing populist. He's like 29, right? No, it's no kidding. It's like that. So, it's of course an interesting photo, you know, with all his anti-migrant statements, and then seeing him with the refugee children laughing. So that gives you the historical perspective of immigration to post-war Austria. Do you see that? So that is here 1960 at the beginning. So basically, until the early 60s, Austria has been predominantly a country of emigration, as it has always been, right? As the Habsburg Empire has been to the United States, as you know, late 19th century, early 20th century, millions of people, and so on. So Austria has been, overall, until the 60s, has been a country of emigration, And you see that begins, so everything about fear is more immigration than emigration. So that begins to change in the early 60s. So why is it in the early 60s? Of course, it's all because of the labor recruitment. And it kicks in later as in Germany, and Germany it begins in the mid-50s with the recruiting. So Austria could compensate that with internal workforce till the early 60s, but then they needed to hire people from the outside. And you can see that here, of course. In these first high numbers, it drops a little bit. It comes to a first very high point in the early mid-70s, and that's just before the oil crisis starts, and so they, you know, then they stop the recruitment. So this is why it goes down here, it drops. But then the families come. It's the same like in Germany, basically. So you have still people coming, and then you have these very high numbers of people immigrating in the 90s with a war in Yugoslavia, of course. And you could say, oh, that's a totally different story. It is not, because, I mean, why did they come to Austria? It's very close, but also because there was a considerable community from Yugoslavia already in place, and that's, of course, very important for refugees, right, when they come. So this is why they came to Austria. So this people coming during the wars in Yugoslavia is very much connected, actually, to the labor recruitment in the early 60s till the mid 70s. So that just gives you basically the same numbers of, you know, net immigration to Austria, and then you see just at the very end, that's 2015, that, I mean, that's really an all-time high, right? So that's 130,000 people immigrating in 1 year. And that, of course, does not count the 800,000 people who came through Austria to Germany, right? And it's a country of 8 million people, right? So so that's really an all-time high, outnumbering also the 90s with the refugees from Yugoslavia. And it's and after Sweden, in relation to the population, Austria is actually the countries that took in really in 2015 most of the asylum requests. Okay, so here you just see it again. I mean, it's just the same thing, but I mean, different numbers and different version of the graph, but it's just the percentage of the non-nationals among the resident population in Austria over the years. So it's from the early 60s, with here a little bit, you know, dropping it, but overall it's constantly going up to more than 12, almost 15% now, right? Okay, so I don't talk about our right-wing populist, or you would call it nativist parties now. You know that the Austrian Freedom Party is, over the last almost 30 years, among the consistently biggest of these nativist populist parties. And from the very beginning, when Haider took over the party in the mid-80s, that was their main agenda. It was anti-immigrant, right? And that stayed, right? And this is from the election in Vienna in 2005. I mean, I guess you read that, right? So it's, and you could never translate it into good English. It's home instead of Islam. In German it sounds, or in Austrian it sounds much better. You have interesting things like, and that's interesting for historians, right? And that's definitely a difference to Germany. That's a cartoon sent out by the Freedom Party to households in Vienna in 2010 for an election. You know, it's, we'll send it out for free. And so what is the historical illusion here? 1683, well, that's a long time ago, right? In terms of historical consciousness. So that's the second siege of Vienna. by the Ottoman Empire, right? So the short version would be in Austria, where that were the Turks, not the Ottoman Empire, right? So that is still very present, only in Vienna. Not in Tyrol, where I teach, nobody cares about that. Germany, nobody would have that on, you know, somewhere. People don't know about it. In Vienna, that it's still very present in the memory of the population. Not that they lived through it, but it is also ingrained in the cityscape and memorials and stuff like that. So it's very interesting that you can play with it, that you have that at hand. I mean, it's a long time ago, right? So that's basically the same. Let's skip that. So let's talk a little bit about the specific historical background in Austria when it comes to migration for the post-war years, right? I mean, there are a few things to keep in mind. So first is, of course, the Habsburg Empire, right? As we already said, right? Not only because of the emigration, right? We forget that, right? I mean, today, being a migrant for economic reasons is actually being an illegal migrant, right? All these people from the Habsburg lands, of course, came to the United States for economic reasons. I mean, what? So then it was not illegal. But today we perceive it as totally illegal to migrate for economic reasons, right? But it's not only important for that immigration. I think it's like almost 5 million people from the Habsburg lands coming to the U.S. in four decades before the First World War. It's also a lot about internal Habsburg migration, right? People from the provinces like Bohemia, Galicia, and so on migrating to the capital, Vienna. And that's not only true for the late 19th century, but also for the early mid-19th century. So already in 1840, you had about 40% of foreigners living in Vienna. And that's the same number today, right? Another important historical layer to keep in mind is, of course, the history of the Third Reich, right? I mean, also when it comes to talking about diversity and all these things in our societies, right? I mean, it's, of course, a very important time to keep in mind. And it's a shared history with Germany, of course. You cannot leave out that, especially that forced labor migration. Right, if you want to talk about migration in Austria in the 20th century, and if you want to understand it, how it works in the post-war years. I mean, the Germans used about 15 million people across Europe for forced labor, and about 3 million of them died, right? And at the end of 1944, there were almost 1 million people as forced laborers on the territory of Austria. Well, that's a pretty significant number, and also all that, I go into that a little bit more in a few minutes. But for example, also the term guest worker that was used in the 60s, actually it only was really used in the 70s. In the 60s you still find that phrases like foreign workers, that's actually a Nazi term. It was coined by the Nazis at the end of the war for people working in the German economy from allied countries. So it's not a nice post-war term, as many people think, to differentiate it from Fremdarbeiter, as they said in Nazi Germany. It's actually a term also coined by the Nazis, very interestingly. And it gets only used very late. So if you read sources, if you read newspapers in Austria and in Germany from the 60s, you still find a lot of, many times you find this term Fremdarbeiter, and the guest worker, Gastarbeiter, only comes in pretty late, actually. Okay, then of course you have, and it's very hard to get good numbers for that, around a million, maybe more. You have, at the end of the Second World War, you have DPs and refugees and, you know, ethnic German expellees on the territory of Austria for some years, but it's hard to get good numbers for that. And then that's a very important part of Austrian post-war history when it comes to this topic. You have the Cold War refugees in Austria, starting with Hungary in 56. So that's around 180,000 people coming to Austria in an extremely short time when the border was open, before they closed it again. And it happens again, Czechoslovakia, 68, around 160,000 people. Again, early 80s with Poland, around the same number, 150,000. This is very important for Austrian historical consciousness because it established the myth that Austria was an open country of you know, solidarity to the to other countries, other neighboring countries, and it was always willing to take in migrants. In fact, you can see, if you go into it, the discourses of these days, you can see that, I mean, it's right. At the beginning, the Austrians were always open to take in people, but the atmosphere switched in, you know, within weeks against the refugees, right? And in fact, most of them did not stay. Most of them, I think only 10% of the Hungarian refugees actually stayed in Austria. Most of them went on to places like the United States and other countries. So just a very small number stayed. But nonetheless, these Cold War refugees were very important for establishing a myth of Austria as a friendly, open country taking in refugees. And it's still, that's still very important today, very present today. So just to show you an example how, again, like the Freedom Party cartoon, how present history is in these discussions in Austria, in the very specific Austrian version. Has anybody seen that? I don't know. Does anybody know that? Okay, so I mean, that's for Austrian post-war history, that's iconic, right? Everybody knows that, basically. That's from the early 70s, 73. So that's when the number of foreign workers in Austria reached a first high point, and just before the oil crisis starts. It's made to foster an understanding of the migrants in Austria, right? The text reads, "My name is," and it's, of course, I mean, as you can see, you know, who's talking? It's the young boy here, right? And he is, you would think he's Austrian, right? Lederhose. "My name is Kolaric. Your name is Kolaric. Why do they call you a Tschusch?" And a Tschusch is, of course, again, it's untranslatable. It's a very derogatory term for people from the Balkans. Let's say it like that.
Right? It's word back for Mexicans, same thing.
Yeah. So, right. So, it, of course, it plays with that Habsburg history, right? I mean, people would say if you read the telephone book in Vienna, it's all Eastern European names, right? Yeah, because they came in the 19th century. But now they are totally assimilated, right? So the point here is, of course, okay, this boy has, you know, ancestors who came from wherever, whatever, I don't know, the Balkans 4 generations ago. Already assimilated, now these guest workers come, and they are, of course, against you know, victims of stereotypes and so on. So that's a very interesting, I mean, it's just very interesting example how present the Austrian history is also in these debates in the 70s. But let's come back to this labor recruitment of the 60s, because, I mean, that's actually the important point, right? I mean, the Austria becomes a country of immigration as Germany with the labor recruitment. Germany starts a little bit earlier, like 10 years earlier almost. Austria starts a little bit later in the 60s. But this is the moment when Austria becomes a country of immigration. And I cannot go into all the details here because I think we're running a little bit out of time. We can do some in the discussion. Austria signed three labor recruitment agreements. Spain had no effect. Only a few people came. They mostly went to France and Germany where they had higher salaries. Turkey and Yugoslavia 64 and 66, which also tells you we just had the 50th anniversary of both of these recruitment agreements.
You didn't have any Italians, because Germany had a large Italian
agreement. Exactly. No. Italians were already in Germany, so there's nothing for Austrians. Right. So that was the point. The base for that it was that Austria was able to take in laborers from foreign countries was this so-called Raab-Ola agreement, which was a secret agreement at these days in 61 between the head of the labor union and of the Chamber of Commerce. Right? I mean, the economy had this interest of bringing in people from other countries. The union was, of course, against it. So they signed this secret agreement. So if you keep it in certain numbers, you are allowed to bring in these. But there's a secret, and it tells you something about the specific post-war constellation in Austria, what we call Sozialpartnerschaft, social partnership, which somehow worked behind the curtains of the official politics, right? I mean, that's an agreement. Of course, they were politicians, but it's an agreement signed by the union and the Chamber of Commerce, and it's not a statement or agreement among parties or in the government. So much of this was part of this social partnership that only collapsed in 2000 when the Freedom Party, together with the Conservative Party, took government. And that's, maybe I end with that, then we have like 10 minutes for discussion and questions. It just gives you, again, an idea, and that also tells you a lot about the situation today. I have no time to go into details here. I mean, those are the laws on which basically the labor recruitment has run in the 60s. And most of them, as you can see, are actually from the interwar period, or also even from the Nazi period, which is interesting. They were still in effect after the war in Austria. And some of these regulations have only been changed in the mid-70s, so after that all started. So that's very interesting, also for the, the historical legacy of the Third Reich, basically. And the two, just like in Germany, the two main principles of this labor recruitment was what we call the primacy of nationals and the rotation, right? So rotation meaning you had to change the workforce every year. They were not allowed to stay longer. Of course, you can imagine that the economy was not happy with that because it makes no sense to bring in new people every year again and to start explaining them what they have to do with their workplace. So that was skipped very early on by the economy. But what was kept was the primacy of nationals, meaning if the economy goes bad, you first have to fire the foreign workforce and only then afterwards the Austrians. Right? So basically it's a legal imbalance between the foreign workforce and the native Austrians. And nonetheless, especially this rotation principle, although it was not in effect, I mean it was technically in effect, but practically it was not used. Because of that, it was so easy for decades to ignore the fact that people came and stayed. What they did from the very beginning, right? I mean, so in the first decades, you really have no feeling, and also if you read newspapers, there's no feeling whatsoever that people actually came to stay. You can only see that in the 80s, that people begin to realize, oh, wait a minute, I mean, there are now workers here for almost 20 years, and they live here, and they have families, and they're
Now their children go to school and so on. That was realized very late in the maybe mid-80s. You can find the first, you know, sources that, you know, give you a side of that. And then it took like, again, 20 years to bring that on a political level, right? So, but I think this is the main, basically the main cause why there is no consciousness of being Austria, of Austria being an immigration country, and why we don't consider it also as part of our history. Which would bring me to the challenges for us historians, but I don't have any time for that, unfortunately. We can do that in the discussion, because it's really not visible in Austrian history, it's not visible in textbooks, it's not visible in museums, it's not visible in overall histories of post-war Austria, maybe just one sentence in thick books. Just not part of our post-war narrative, which is not only about migration, of course, but also about social diversity, right? I mean, we have no way to handle diversity in our historical narratives in post-war Austria, which is, I guess, the major problem now. And to bring that into the picture, what we try to do now with many projects at my institute in Innsbruck is not that easy, because it's even not easy to find the sources for that. I mean, Austrian archives destroyed sources related to that history because they thought it's just a part of our history. Why would we preserve that? Right? There's no documentation from the recruitment office in Belgrade, for example, that recruited the workers in Yugoslavia. It was destroyed after they shut it down. And so on and so on. I could go on, you know, hours here. Just to give you an idea how complicated it is actually to arrive at a inclusive inclusive history of post-war Austria that also brings in the story of stories of migration and of migrants. Okay, and maybe I should just stop here and leave it to the discussion.
Well, thank you very much.